meeting of the pensions committee, and just a couple of apologies I have at the moment. Adrian Jones is not really well, so I won't be here tonight. Also have apologies from John Fulton from St. Helens Council, who's engaged in other meetings this evening. And as far as I'm aware, they're the only two apologies I have. Takes us over to the main body of our meeting this evening. The first agenda item, item 3, Yvonne will talk us through. Officers believe that as the funds recording efforts to support employers to
membership this year would not be considered as a material breach. It's also expected that the corrective actions being undertaken will result in an increased issue next year. Section 2.13 to 17 covers the government's response to the consultation on the public sector exit payment cap and confirms that the government will introduce the cap as part of the enterprise bill. HMT response notes that the motion respondents oppose the inclusion of early retirement strains within the cap on the basis that it would impact on workforce plan and affect employees on moderate salaries and long stays. However, despite this opposition, it is still the government's view that strain costs must be included to ensure early retirement is not used as a mechanism to avoid the cap. The bill is making its way through Parliament, and LGA will discuss how the cap will fit with the LGPS regulations. Section 2.18 notes that when we'll set an inflation figure, which is used to index benefits from foreign aid to a negative value around 0.1%. Pensions and payments or deferred benefits will be reduced. However, for benefits built up under the care scheme, a reduction may apply for active members if the government issues an exit treasury revaluation order. Section 8 is awareness that if a negative treasury order is issued, this will require additional resources to communicate with members, and there will be cost incurred to amend pension increase programmes. In addition, the zero increase to pensions and payments may prompt queries from pensioners as their state pensions will increase by at least 2.5% as a result of the triple lock guarantee. The recommendation is that members note the clause and happy to take any questions. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Yvonne. Have we got any questions? Okay. Treena, and then Anne.
I'd just like to make those thanks to the staff. In all their efforts to submit this information to this department.
Mine was on the same theme, Chair, given the, you know, the bringing forward of the deadline for the issuing, and that we issued nearly 35,000. The officers of the fund are to be thanked for all the work that obviously went into doing the data, getting the data up to date, but we're all IT services as well for getting them collated and posted. And I can record our thanks, Chair.
Thank you. Sorry, Pat, did you put your hand up before?
No, I didn't. I thought
it was sadly. Certainly, as Chair, I'd like to add my thanks to the officers. I mean, moving the deadline forward and all the work that went into that, I think the funds did very, very well. Particularly taking into light that many of the funds didn't comply at all. So once again, and I think this committee recognises the efforts of the staff and officers. And again, reminded the fact that where pressure comes upon our staff, we should consider that perhaps in future meetings and committee meetings, the need to reflect upon and make sure that we have the resources to meet the deadlines that are imposed upon us. Well, thank you. I think we're all grateful for that. Thank you. So, Yvonne, you're on to our next agenda item.
Members are asked to note and approve the breaches policy civil offence, which can result in penalties. Section 8 highlights that all those responsible for evaluating and reporting breaches will be encouraged to complete the e-learning programme reporting breaches of the law on the regulator's website. The recommendation is that members are asked to note and adopt the breaches policy, note and approve the appointment of the responsible officer, and note and approve that an electronic decision-making process be adopted to obtain agreement from the board as to whether a breach should or should not be reported to the regulator. I'm happy to answer any questions on the policy documents.
So, obviously, comprehensive reports on the policy. Has anyone got any questions that you'd like to ask?
You did say that there could be a training opportunity that takes about half an hour.
Yeah.
Pension committee members, can you just give us a bit of information?
Yeah, it's on the pension regulator's website. It's under the public sector toolkit, and it's in 7 modules. But the particular module that we're sort of talking about here is reports and breaches of the law to the regulator. There's an assessment that you want to take, and also a training program. It takes about, I would say, an hour to complete.
Thank you. Perhaps you could report back to us and tell us how you get on with that. Thank you. So there is a recommendation that we note this agenda item, which is a review of the new policy. Will this be reported on a regular basis? A regular agenda item, is that what was just made that?
Indicated the government's intention to invite local authorities to come forward with criteria for delivering savings, and that consultation is to be published later on this year. Under Section 2.4, in his speech at the party conference, the Chancellor again referred to the pooling of LGPS assets and announced that he was going to work with the ministry authorities to bring together investments into up to six pools spread across the country, creating conditions to save hundreds of millions in costs and invest billions in infrastructure in the regions. Section 2.5, to date there have been a number of activities both by officers and by the chair of the committee in relation to attending a number of events and regular conference calls. Section 2.6, we'd expected the November consultation paper by now, but it's expected imminently, and it will cover those four areas: legislative changes to give the Secretary of State increased powers, proposed changes to the investment regulations, acceptable criteria for pooling, and backstop measures. The criteria that we expect to set out under Section 2.7, the principal ones being size, with £30 billion calls being mentioned, cost savings, with again substantial cost savings anticipated, and finally governance. It's also thought there might be one or two subsidiary criteria, such as additional investment in infrastructure and the timeliness of the implementation of the proposals brought forward. Under Section 2.11, officers are currently working with a number of other local authority funds, and there are several work streams being undertaken in conjunction with Hyman's Robertson, who are effectively providing secretarial support in terms of organising conference calls, providing minutes, and also a lot of data is being collected both from local authority funds and from investment managers who are providing information on fees, information on mandate sizes, and all that information is being collated with a view to informing the decision going forward. Under Section 2.14, where we set out the pooling options, it seems that pooling at a regional level is the government's default option. An option, and the officers are considering a number of options which would enable the fund to take, one, to protect its position, and secondly, take advantage of opportunities. Under 2.16, we set out a number of factors that we're considering in assessing pooling options. I draw particular attention to the need for the fund to retain a key role in the governance of any pool structure, that those funds that we work with would be helpful if they have a like-minded or have a complementary investment philosophy, and clearly we think it's important that the opportunity is taken to, where possible, increase internal management capability and the ability to make local investments, and again the opportunity to add additional resilience and capacity over and above the current governance structures. Under 2.17, we set out timescales. We're hoping the consultation will be issued this month. There's a statutory 12-month consultation response period, so responses will be required in February next year. It's also expected that draft investment regulations will be available probably by March next year, and the Chancellor is looking for responses from funds so that he has something to say in his budget statement in the first half of next year. And then the expectation is that the creation of the pools will be phased in over the life of the Parliament, so that liquid assets will be easy to pool more quickly. The illiquid assets that funds hold, there'll be a slower process for those to be brought together. Under Section 5, the Chair of Pensions Committee has been consulted and is involved in a number of meetings that are taking place with DCLG and other LGPS funds. Under Section 8, the intention is that substantial savings will be delivered without affecting investment performance. and it's expected that the work being coordinated by Hans Robertson will provide credible data which will inform the costs of the various options and potential savings for this committee to consider. And the recommendation is that members note the report, authorise officers in conjunction with the chair to continue developing pooling options to bring further papers to this committee, and clearly any decision will be subject to committee approval. But there are very tight timescales. We have Christmas between now and a response to the government's consultation, which is why a lot of preparatory work is being undertaken at the moment. Thank you, Chair.
On a personal note, I'd like to thank Peter actually for a lot of the work he's already done. It is noted within the report that we need to get a move on, we need to start talking to other like-minded authorities. As Peter's commented on, we have met with a number of local authorities, particularly in the north of England, Manchester, West Yorkshire, Lancashire, West Midlands and other authorities. I mean, I have some reservations as to what cost savings will be made out of all of this exercise, in as much as it will cost money to actually bring the funds together in the first instance. But I do believe that there will be an opportunity to do larger infrastructure investment as we bring funds together. Obviously, on a personal note, I'd like to see the opportunity for us to do local infrastructure investment, and my initial thoughts were that we would talk to authorities in the sort of Northern Powerhouse area, so obviously Manchester and similar authorities in the area. But as you talk to them, you do realise that they work quite differently to our own in the way that they invest, whether they do internal investments or external fund managers. And so there's lots of work for the officers and staff to do in bringing this together. And as Peter said, I've personally spent a bit of time just in the local government association and in regular weekly meetings, which also Joe has been in attendance in. His guidance. So that's been grateful for that. And as Peter's recommended, that we first of all look at the basis of going forward as detailed in item 216, that we approve the recommendations there in how we select our investment partners, and the report come back to us at a later date. But after those comments, is there any more questions?
Chair, I absolutely echo your comments there about like-minded partners in terms of philosophy, because it's a philosophy that served this fund very well and it's been very, very successful. And I also would endorse one of the key factors in terms of the government's issue, that we do have a pivotal role in terms of governance going forward. And for me, they'd be two of the very key things to come out of the, you know, what we'd want to see is the basic tenets in any agreement going forward.
Yeah, could I just pick up on this point in 2.14 about this indication that savings might be achieved through more kind of passive management. Is that our expectation that if this goes ahead, or as it goes ahead, that there will be more funds invested passively? So I'm just thinking ahead to something like the fossil fuel investment underwriting and Cllr, as is. That's one of the issues with that if a lot of funds are managed passively, because those kind of funds are overrepresented in the kind of investments that are managed passively. So is that something that you expect to happen, that there will be more kind of passive investment?
I'm glad you asked for clarification, because I realise the report isn't as clear as it could be. Previously, the government had indicated it was thinking of making a wholesale change and effectively mandating all LGPS funds to invest passively. It seems that has been moved away from. You'll be aware that ourselves as a fund have a proportion of passive, a proportion of active, and a proportion of alternative. I don't think that will change for us specifically, and I don't think that will necessarily change across the LGPS. It's more the bringing together of those managers. rates will enable fee discounts from bulk buying effectively rather than from a greater proportion of assets being the management asset.
I think one of the things we have to recognise, and in the discussions I've been involved in, each of the funds has their own identity. And talking to West Yorkshire, they have an identity. There were people in West Yorkshire area recognise the fact that they have a good pension fund. They talk about it, well known. I think Merseyside Pension Fund is well known and respected. I think we have to recognise that we have a skill set, we have officers who are well experienced, and as we move forward then we'll need to bring those skills to the front. And so perhaps what will happen is that we'll get the opportunity to expand in certain areas, perhaps we'll divest some of our responsibilities to other funds, and so I think certain change will come about, but I think it's important that we maintain our own identity as a pension fund and we build upon the skills and invest in our officers and team that we already have. But certainly we're hoping to look for opportunities to invest in bigger opportunities to bring about returns for our pensioners and also build upon local investment opportunities as well. But you know, my view is at first that you know it's going to be us in Manchester and Lancashire, and that might not be the case. We'll need to see how it works because they may work very differently. So I guess we'll end up seeing who we are in partnership with at a later date. Sorry, Treena.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Given that we do have such a time scale, looking at the consultation responses, February 2016, is there any way that the committee could have maybe some sort of briefing presentation from other like-minded pension funds that we are considering that would be helpful for the committee to make a decision?
I think that's a very good point. I think, personally, myself, I've been working on this in meetings with other funds and with the LGA for about two months or so, and then Peter and I. I think one of the challenges with the time scales, Treena, is bringing the committee together to talk with all the individual funds who may come to us. I was quite surprised when I went to, and then Joe was there, Peter, the three of us, I was personally surprised when I went to a meeting of funds from the north, and we had people from the south who pretended to be northerners, but they didn't call me for 1 minute. But and then I've been talking to Manchester Pension Fund and getting their views, but they've been talking to Strathclyde, so it's hard to know who we would bring together to talk to. I think what we have to do is agree upon the principles on which we would work with another fund, allow the officers to bring a report to us, and then maybe, yes, we might have an event where we bring members together from the funds and whom we'd recommend that we would pool with, really, at a later date.
No, that'd be great.
But there are opportunities. I mean, for example, this Monday, it might be short notice, but I'm going to an investment conference with other local authority funds in London, and so members who might like to involve themselves in that, I might be happy for anyone to tag along, but it is quite time consuming. I'm probably doing about 2 or 3 days a month at the moment at least, and the officers are giving very freely of their time as well. But I think the best way forward personally, my recommendations committee, is we allow the officers to bring the recommendation based upon the principles we've spoken about here. Is there any other questions? Sorry. So we're happy to go with the recommendations of the report then. Thank you. So agenda item 6 is the bond review of options.
Approval to amend the panel of increasing persons who can consider appeals into the RDRP process. This is due to the former independent officer's recent retirement, and it is proposed that the acting 151 officer fills this role in order to demonstrate continuous impartiality when reconsidering formal determinations at the stage 2 of the process. The recommendation is that members of the
note that recommendation. Absolutely. Thank you. Okay, and again, agenda item 7, which Peter's going to talk us through.
Thank you, Chair. I trust this is relatively straightforward as well. The fund has a governance policy which it publishes. We need to update it for two principal reasons. Firstly, the introduction of the local pension board and the fact that that's now part of the fund's governance arrangements. Secondly, the fact that we have a strategic director to whom I report rather than a director of finance. And so the introduction of the strategic director and myself as head of the pension fund within that scheme of delegation is included in the governance policy, which is attached in the appendix to the report. Members are asked to approve the updated governance policy. Thank you, Chair.
Are there any questions about that updated policy? Are we happy with the officer's recommendations to approve? Okay, again over to Peter for agenda item 8, responsible investment and final risk.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We were asked to bring this report following Pensions Committee on the 28th of September when there were questions around the management of climate change risk by the fund. In the report, we set out a fair amount of background information, section 2.2. Members will be aware of the proposed meeting in December this year in relation to climate change negotiations in Paris with the intention of limiting the increase in global warming to 2 degrees of pre-industrial levels. Clearly there's no certainty about the outcome of those negotiations, but there's a fair degree of scientific consensus about the need to reduce increases in global temperatures. Under section 2.3, we draw attention to some widely regarded studies which suggest that investors are exposed to the risk of stranded assets, which effectively means that if global warming is to be, or the increase in global warming and the 2 degree target is to be achieved, then there are certain fossil fuel intensive industries that won't be able to make use of the reserves that they hold. And the Chancellor is one of a number of people who has addressed that risk and suggested that there could be a wholesale reassessment of prospects if there was a sudden change to carbon prices. Section 2.4, there have been a number of prominent campaigns to which the fund has responded. There's an online database giving details of fossil fuel holdings of LGPS funds in particular. And Fossil Free UK made the ethical and environmental arguments for divestment alongside the financial one, which is the risk of substantial loss of capital value owing to exposure to stranded assets. We go on to say that alongside the challenges of implementation, there is a counter-argument that holds that divestment is a suboptimal strategy to address climate risk for an institutional investor with a long-time horizon. We explain a bit more about that under section 2.5. The fund has been very active over a number of years, principally through its membership of LAF, and one of the appendices has been produced by LAF in relation to this topic. We refer to the fund supporting co-filing of resolutions both in relation to Shell and BP, which has been successful in those companies, providing more information to investors on their carbon risk. Under section 2.6, we point out that divestment would bring the strategy of engagement to an end. Section 2.7, pleased to draw attention to the fact that we have more than £200 million presently committed to the low carbon economy through a number of the fund's assets, infrastructure, private equity, and property. under section 2.8, while full divestment of all fossil fuel related investments within 5 years may be viewed as incompatible with the fund's strategic objectives and fiduciary obligations, further climate risk strategies could be explored within the parameters of the current strategic asset allocation and manager mix. And there's a suggestion which we come to in the recommendation that members are asked to consider authorising officers to explore three things. Firstly, enhanced disclosure in line with the UN Montreal Pledge. Secondly, to explore options to decarbonise our passive equity holdings. And then thirdly, to consider signing up to the Portfolio Decarbonisation Coalition, which involves setting explicit reduction targets. In the three following paragraphs, we provide a bit more information about the implications of those. Firstly, the UN Montreal Pledge is around improved reporting, which enables improved management, and the fund has worked hard with a number of other investors to encourage companies to report information on a consistent basis, because once consistent information is held, it's easier to engage with and manage those risks. In relation to decarbonising, sorry about this awful jargon, our passive equities, but there's evidence that we'll be able to do that with a modest increase in risk, providing a fairly significant reduction in the carbon footprint of our portfolio. And then thirdly, in relation to the Portfolio Decarbonisation Coalition, we have some reservations in the short term about signing up to a binding commitment to reduce our carbon footprint until we have some more information about what our carbon footprint is. Under Section 3, we set out some of those risks, and we recognise that we should do more to effectively communicate some of the good things that we're already doing. Under Section 8, the initiatives set out will have a financial cost should they be implemented, but we think we can investigate them fairly inexpensively and bring a further report to this committee. So the recommendations are that members reaffirm the commitment to responsible investment and to approve further investigation of alternative investment approaches to climate risk mitigation and adaptation, and that a further report is brought to this committee providing more information on the implications of those alternative investment approaches to climate risk. Thank you, Chair.
Members, any questions on the report?
I'm sure you're surprised I'll have a few comments and questions if I may, but thanks very much to Peter for bringing forward that report. I very much enjoyed reading it, following the request that we made at the last committee. I suppose what concerns me as a committee member is it's not impossible to imagine a scenario, say, in the next 5-10 years, where we have a very sudden reduction in the value of fossil fuel company assets. I mean, that could certainly happen. I suppose the question we'd be asked then is what were you doing to kind of deal with that risk? You know, couldn't you see that coming? Peter referred to the Chancellor, unfortunately, as the Governor of the Bank of England, not the Chancellor, who's kind of warning us about all this stuff. I wish he was the Chancellor as well. But you know, he's been very, very cogent about this, isn't he? You know, he's clearly pointing to the risk of financial instability arising out of it. So that would be my kind of concern. What are we doing as a committee to kind of deal with that risk? And what is the pension fund doing to address that? So what I was kind of hoping to read before I read this report, the key kind of questions I had were, first of all, you know, what is our exposure to this impact with respect to fossil fuel assets? And what proportion of the fund is invested in fossil fuels? And not just in fossil fuels in general, but specifically, say, coal as opposed to oil and gas, which is the most carbon intensive fossil fuel. And some funds, I think I'm right in saying the Norwegian fund has or is divesting from coal, but not from oil and gas. So that there's a different degree of risk obviously associated with these different assets. So what I would like to see is, you know, what are our investments in fossil fuels and how is that broken down, say, between coal and oil and gas? And then secondly, what kind of strategy do we have to deal with what the Governor of the Bank of England is warning us about? What strategy do we have to mitigate fossil fuel risk does that reflect the urgency that he's kind of pointing us towards? And then thirdly, kind of what positive steps is the fund taking to help engineers shift away from fossil fuels? And can we publish details in terms of, you know, local sustainable infrastructure investment to promote good practice, not just locally, but across the local government pension schemes? So in terms of what I read and how to kind of address the concerns at hand, we've got the specific kind of recommendations. So hopefully Peter can correct me if I'm wrong, but in terms of the first question, I'm assuming that if we kind of sign up to the Montreal Carbon Pledge, that that would kind of enshrine that we would have to report on our fossil fuel holdings, that would be kind of more transparent in that respect.
Yes, that's correct.
Good, okay. Secondly, in terms of the urgency that's involved, that's kind of what concerns me more in a sense. Are the measures that we're proposing here, are they sufficiently urgent to deal with what could happen in the future? And I suppose what I would definitely like to see here is more of a specific timetable. We were asked to recommend a further report before this meeting. Can we put a timescale of that? Can we say the next pension committee will have a report to that effect? Is that reasonable? And then thirdly, it's already referred to, I think, in 2.7 about the existing £200 million of investments in the low carbon economy. And I presume the intention is to list those and make that transparent. Again, can that be done fairly precipitously? But again, I think if we can see, so I look at the annual report and I can see that the top 10 shareholdings of BP and Shell are right up there. It would be nice to see something similar that actually outlines some of the more positive investments the fund is making. So I guess there's a bunch of questions there. In terms of the urgency, really, you know, in terms of when we can expect to see the next report.